Every great century that produces art is so far an artificial century. And the work that seems the most natural and simple of its time is always the result of the most self-conscious effort.
Imagine that liberation of mind for the first time. For the first time. How those kids just went mad. Wow, we can have sex and drugs and oh, we can be anything we want to be. We wear makeup and we can wear anything we want to be and people think we're cool. It's like a fantasy world, I suppose.
For once, there was an unknown land, full of strange flowers and subtle perfumes. A land of which it is joy of all joys to dream. A land where all things are perfect and poisonous.
Well, you're the grand one, have you noticed? When you're walking, all the fairy boys are feeling nervous. Well, my starship doesn't want me, and neither does his world.
Political, you know, sensibilities were being activated. There was gay rights, there was feminism, there was a lot of stuff that was sort of ignored, I think, in the 60s. I think the 60s had a real misogynist, a homophobic aspect to them.
It was a very brief moment where suddenly that kind of gender bending was not only acceptable, it was encouraged and almost necessary to be successful. I mean, even bands like the Kinks and the Stones were, you know, wearing feather boas.
That's me! That's me! That's me!
I mean, everybody knows most people are bisexual.
Any more questions?
I was...
woman with the beret.
I was under the impression that you...
I was born in 71, so I kind of missed it. I was running around countryside in Scotland when this was all going on. I love all that stuff. I love the idea of ending going and the bisexuality being hip. But at the same time, there was a lot of hypocrisy in it, and people saying they were gay and bisexual who weren't, and, you know, it was just a hip scene to be in. Whereas the people that were leading it truthfully, and we are gay and we are bisexual, and they were the cool people. One of the first times you see me in the movie, I think, where I'm playing this concert, and the audience is mainly hippies, and they're not into what we're doing at all, and then I'm doing my stuff and they don't like it, and then I egg them on and they like that even less. Oh yeah, I have to dive into the crowd and they hold me up and I do a bit of stuff and they set fire to me and all that kind of stuff. It's kind of action glam. You know, Schwarzenegger meets T-Rex, maybe. Yeah, I love this stuff. I like the performance because I want to be a rock star, really.
So he, you know, performed, sang the songs live, and then did these unbelievably strenuous, you know, outrageous performances, you know, that, of course, drew a great deal from things we've all seen and read about Iggy Pop, with a little bit of Lou Reed thrown in there as well. But he just blew us all away.
Well, I was 12. I didn't really understand it. My grandmother told me she saw a picture of Alice Cooper, who was kind of an American equivalent to British glam rock. On the cover of a magazine when I was 11 or 12 years old, and said, "He's going to burn in hell." And of course, I was intrigued immediately by this person. I wanted to know about him. Well, I think when punk rock was ushered in, it was a little bit more of a sexless musical revolution. Of course, it was incredibly sexy in its own way, but I think politically, things just changed dramatically, you know, in the mid-70s. That this is a period of time that had great style and great humor about itself and was able, in British words, to take the piss out of itself, at the same time saying something and having a good time while saying it. I think that's what a lot of that is about.
It's a crown, your mystica, momentary seizure of love.
So you're saying you're bisexual?
Yeah, I like boys, I like girls. They're all great. No difference, is there? Mr. BBC.
I'm not really myself, except in the midst of elegant crowds, at the heart of rich districts, amid the sumptuous ornamentation of palace hotels, an army of servants, and plush carpet underfoot.
And it's really, truly a bisexual love story in that it also very, you know, sort of romantically describes the marriage between Brian Slade and Mandy Slade initially, and then Brian sort of getting very also completely sort of smitten with this character from New York named Kurt Wilde.
Love is tough and it takes effort and work. And I don't think Brian Slade was into effort and work much.
People generally aren't good with change, I don't think. And things are just constantly changing in this. I use you and I confuse you. And
now it's you. Still you won't suspect me.
The relationship's obviously very strong and one that's based in love. And so that makes it, but like a lot of love affairs, it's like over as soon as it started, you know.
Mandy is a very, very, very complex character. She had to be his door kicker. She also had to watch him do whatever he wants to do.
They both wanted to kind of be out there, you know. And he came first, and she never got her chance. Her window never opened. And I don't think she ever forgave him for that.
Who would you most fancy meeting in America?
Kurt Wilde. Satellite of love. Satellite of love. Kurt was in love with Brian, and Brian was in love with Kurt, and it just couldn't mix. Two very, very selfish people.
Yeah, massive egos, yeah. His is bigger than mine, though, in terms of character, you know. I think
that's a love story in a lot of different ways, and then it's the story of this kid named Arthur from Manchester, who I think maybe we can all identify with the most in the film.
He's sort of the narrator in a way. I mean, got kicked out of his own house because of his glam attraction and everything that went with that. You know, and it's the only period of his life that he can look back on and really sort of see as a happy moment.
It was set in the 1970s. It could be any era because it's people. The movie's just about people and how being true to yourself was the greatest mask you could possibly put on. Because nobody can conceivably believe at that point in time that you could be anything you wanted to be.
Well, England's such a tight, classist society. And these people were just like, yeah, free for all, you know? Suddenly there was this fresh, vibrant, new outlook, which basically accepted everything. It was like, be who you want to be and love it. So these people had complete freedom and they created so many different personas for themselves.
I wanted to bury the past in the film, and so there would always be this nostalgia and the sense of something dangerous and exciting that was closed up that Arthur as a character has to sort of dig out, you know. So from the beginning of the movie, there's this enormous sense of loss and of longing for a past that we've forgotten or that we buried, and you know, yeah, I'm playing it up.
You don't see many great painters or many great filmmakers who just make funny, happy films, or funny, happy songs, or funny, happy paintings. They don't. All the best ones delve into the world of tragedy, because out of tragedy is beauty.
And I remember going to the movies when I was a kid and feeling that thrill about going on some unknown trip somewhere. And that's, I would love Velvet Goldmine to have that feeling about it.
Nothing is ever as simple as it might seem in his movies. And that's definitely the case with Velvet Goldmine.
If you're creating a myth, initially, artificially, the best way to really pull it off is to become the myth.
Because the secret of becoming a star is knowing how to behave like one. Action!
What's true about music is true about life. The beauty reveals everything. because it expresses nothing.
I'm only 24. I was born in 72, my God. But I certainly did love, I got so into the music making the movie, and I still am.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and whomever else may be in the house this evening, I give you Brian Slade!
I guess the sound and the content shared a great deal, which it was extremely ornate and melodic and very produced, but not in a slick way as much as a embellished. The music was dressed up. It drew from the hard, sort of threatening, anti-hippie sounds of the Velvet Underground and the Stooges, and that kind of violence. The violence of the music certainly was there, and the sexual violence that comes from those groups was definitely a part of it. But it wouldn't have happened without the music hall vaudevillian tradition that seems to me so completely British mixing in with that.
I didn't know the music, it wasn't what I was brought up with, so I had to basically backtrack. And I think now that maybe it was better, because people actually use musical instruments instead of computers. Glitter. Even the music had glitter on it. Today there's no glitter, it's all dense bass. It had glitter, I think so. It had makeup. Music had makeup.
Some of the stuff that they were doing back then was so radical and so creative, really. Not just musically, but in terms of production, in terms of what they were doing in the studio, slamming together and trying different ideas. And some of it was, you know, abject failure, but a lot of it was really inspired.
And the mixture of those elements, the theatricality mixed in with the raunchy, very frank sexuality of it all is apparent in the music itself. You don't even have to listen to the words or understand them, I think, to feel that in the music. To see you were meant for me, yeah. I'm your toy,
your 20th century boy. It's swinging, it's rock, it's got beautiful romantic sweeps in it. It carries you along, it's a soundtrack to a dream.
Baby's on fire, I better throw her in the water. Look at her laughing like a heifer to the slaughter. Baby's on fire, and all the laughing boys are bitching, waiting for photos. Oh, the plot is so bewitching.
I think it's aggressive artificiality and sort of celebration of artifice and rejection of the natural in every way frightened people off. And that it's much easier to sort of revitalize and kind of reinvent moments in pop culture that seem to be about something raw and truthful and earnest, like punk or like, you know, grunge or like some of 60s music, than it is to, I think there's something a little more prickly and more complex.
Why the makeup?
Why? Because rock and roll is a prostitute. It should be tarted up, performed. The music is the mask, while I am my chiffon and taff.
It was high performance in a way that I think you only see certain periods that pushed it to that extreme in rock, in popular music.
The first duty in life is to assume a pose. What the second duty is, no one has yet found out.
It was colorful, beautiful loud colors, flamboyance, flares, lots of material being used, playful.
people with boas, glamour, the glitter. Innocent, just like a child dressing up, you know, a fantasy, escape.
The look of it, I mean, everything is recycled. I mean, people today are like so into the 70s and then there are older folk kind of looking at them going, I was there, you're a fool, give it up.
I can make you a star.
I was like a really young teenager in the sort of early 70s. And all the stuff that I've been able to produce on this is stuff that I wanted to wear then but couldn't because I was too young. I kind of did the best I could, you know, and made my own versions, but I really aspired to be able to wear all these fantastic things that I could see other people wearing. So it's really exciting for me now to be able to do it.
It was about going out on the street and pushing it as far as you can, and almost in a way pushing it in people's faces a bit and saying, I don't care, and you can, you know, you can just get out of my face if you don't like it, and so on and so forth.
It appears today's youngsters have fashioned a whole new bent on the so-called sexual liberation of the flower power set. The long hair and love beads have given way to glitter makeup, platform shoes, and a whole new taste for glamour, nostalgia, and just plain outrageousness.
Is London not shocked?
London is improving.
Well, I think it's a disgrace. Raiding around all ponced up like a pack of bleeding woofters. Bloody hell, what do they think up next?
It was wanting to really push and provoke, and everything was for a reaction.
Tell us, Brian, are the rumors true when they say you and Kurt Wilde have some sort of plans up your sleeve?
Oh, yes. Quite soon we actually plan to take over the world.
Everyone says, you know, if you lived through the 60s, you don't remember. And it's perfectly true, I'm afraid. I realised I actually remembered very little, and the 60s and 70s got very mulched together. So it's quite difficult to differentiate the different periods, make sense of them.
Outrageous, bizarre, freaky, well, obviously glamorous, because a lot of it was inspired by the 30s, Hollywood 30s, 1930s.
Cheers. Extraordinary.
I think the costumes in the period automatically tell the audience, this is who I am. I'm Brian Slade, I wear these clothes and I live in this country and I'm alive at this time. So immediately you're sold to the audience.
Brian! Maxwell Demon is the story of a space creature who becomes a rock and roll messiah, only to be destroyed by his own success. Are you saying this is your destiny? Are you Maxwell Demon?
Man is least himself when he talks in his own person. Give him a mask and he'll tell you the truth.
I mean, I'm lucky because the stuff I'm doing is kind of rock. I'm the leather clad kind of, I'm the butchest person in it, you know? And, so I've got off lightly, but some of it just drives me up the wall. I can't stand it.
It was a joke at the time. I think people looked ridiculous, but it's really fun.
The whole 70s thing was about image. Everyone sort of discovered that the image was very, very important. I mean, they had before with Teddy Boys and stuff, but then this really came to the fore with the Mark Bolans and David Bowies and who God knows who else, New York Dolls and all the rest of them, and all trying to create their own image.
The blue screen sailor, you're the grand one. Come and call me. Cause this wooing is what...
You know, you look back on parts of being a teenager, and a lot of it is very embarrassing, the sort of clothes that you started wearing and all of that. And obviously, this is not an exception at all. I mean, look at us all. But I mean, what it represented to me is not sad at all. And, you know, it was a very important part of my life and something that I dearly love.
I could remember quite a bit, but the sort of stuff I could remember was the stuff that myself, my contemporaries were wearing. So we kind of used that for like the glitter kids, the young fans, the sort of like 13 to 16 year olds.
The greatest challenge was really just making it be believable, even though you're dealing with something that's quite sort of extraordinary. You had to make sure it felt real. So that's when, for instance, dealing with the audience and the fans and the kids, trying to make it look like they've done it themselves.
As you say, yes, it's all to do with shadows and illusions and what's behind the illusion, and is there anything behind the illusion at all?
Hail to the monkey, we're having a funky reunion.
As a time where anything went, that's an incredibly powerful and positive thing. And now it's not the case anymore, you know. We really have jumped backwards, I think. Still, we shouldn't all wear flares and flowery shirts because we do look ridiculous, so I'm glad we got out of that.
Everybody, I'd like to introduce you to our lovely new wardrobe mistress.
What's her name? Didn't you play him?
Shannon.
Welcome, Shannon.
The estate gives characteristically cynical evidence, replete with pointed epigram and startling paradox, while explaining his views on morality in art.
I'm always very interested in topics in my films that call notions of identity into question and call sort of natural ideas about you know, humankind, you know, that there's sort of a prescribed organic way of living in our culture, and so this was a sort of celebration of very much the Oscar Wilde tradition played out in pop culture, you know.
Is it your belief that all dandies are homosexual?
Ha! Nothing makes one so vain as being told one is a sinner.
Velvet Goldmine, the title of the film, comes from a B-side that David Bowie wrote, a song from the 72. I don't know if it was ever officially released in the States or not. It's a wonderful song.
This is a rock and roll movie, you know. It's a movie about music stars and rock and roll stars and parties and the whole band thing.
So many different things, you know. It's a really multi-layered film, and a lot of people, when they read the script, they just didn't get it, you know. They were just, ooh, what's that about? When I first read it, I loved it, thought it was brilliant, but it was, I sort of likened it to a pop song that you really love. You can't quite explain what it's about, you know, and you keep, the more you listen to it, you hear new lyrics, you know, maybe you can't quite hear what the singer's saying, but you like the sound of his voice, and you learn new things about it the more that you go back and, you know, delve into it.
Is it here then? Let's have a look. Bloody Nora. Oh, kids, one of them pansy rockers.
Fucking hell.
It's fucking Puff, that one there.
It's not.
That's Naff.
That's Naff.
Disgusting. You know that.
What is the script? You know, it's an incredible piece of writing. It's completely brilliant. It's so fragmented and so representative of the kind of image we have of the 70s, because it's all over the place. It's mad and it's exciting and it's beyond comprehension, really. Some of it, people talk about scenes and you go, where's that? And then you go back and you read the script and there's a whole scene that you just never went in your mind, you know.
My career was on the skids, mate, and you fished me out of the muck. You got me back on my feet, you did.
It was nothing, chum. I wanted to help you make more of that far-out sound. I love your music, my son. And I love... You don't have to say it, mate.
I read this script and I thought I'm completely wrong for it. I'm so wrong, but I fucking love it. And I have to... I faxed Todd and I just had to do it, you know? I'm so in love with it and I can't wait to see it. I think it's brilliant.
When you're trying to be truthful and speak from the heart, but you are, you know, you're an institution unto yourself and you're making huge amounts of money and there's corporations financing you, the contradictions of that direct statement from the heart, by the time it gets into the hands of the kids out there, whatever, is so contradicted, I think, at so many levels, that when you set out to sort of tell the truth, I think you always fail.
The whole film's loaded with contradictions about itself, as was the era. You know, just I contradict myself 10, 15 times a day. I think one thing and mean the other. And it's... I don't know. I think it's confusing. I think everything is confusing. I think the CPK is confusing. I think going back and thinking about it now is even more confusing than before I started it, because I'm trying to think, is this part of my past or is it part of somebody else's? Was that really me doing that? Because I don't know what's going to come up on that screen at all. And it's going to frighten the shit out of me. Because I don't know, was it me or was it what things affected me at that time?
I knew I should create a sensation, go off to the rocket. And he went out.